right, so welcome back to Morning Cafe. We have, of course, passed maybe that beat of discussing what is on the newspaper and the stories that we had. It's now time that we cross over to that segment where we take a look at these issues that we've captured, also we've touched on a comprehensive perspective. And joining me this morning is Joy Mdivo and, of course, Kijana Steve to expound some more on these particular issues that affect us directly. Our main focus for the day will be, of course, on the COVID-19 cases that we are experiencing right now in the country. And we also take a look at the struggles and tussles that are ongoing in Nairobi in terms of power. And we take a look also at the budgets, especially now that they hit hard on Waiguru. You know, a majority of our pundits argued that, yes, if Waiguru were to sail through from the impeachment process that was tabled by the members of the county assembly, then it would be obvious that he's going to have it so rough, you know, manning the county for the rest of the days of his of her term. And clearly looks like this is playing out. And we also take a look at how hard COVID-19 has hit government offices, and not just government offices, but even private sector, but different offices are now closing down. You know, staff being forced to go on quarantine or isolation because of these cases that have been recorded. And lastly, we take a look at the shuffles that have played out within the House committees or committees in Parliament, and we see of what impact they are, especially on matters politics right here in the country. So, ladies and gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for your time. And of course, as we delve deep into these discussions that are ongoing, and COVID-19 has hit the county so hard. Machakos talking of 68 out of 97 cases that were recorded from one factory. And I mean, the counties have been left with the burden, or to bear the brunt of the burden, or I mean, of ensuring that we are able to successfully win the fight against COVID-19. Remember, President Uhuru Kenyatta in his address in June, arguing that we are only going to reopen if we have the counties, first of all, also achieving the 300 beds capacity, which is not something that has been achieved. But then it looks like it is hitting hard at this level of the counties. And almost all the counties now have recorded these cases. We're standing at 47 something counties having the COVID-19. Of course, mainly it's hit them respectively. What does it mean? Where does it place us on this fight? Are we looking at a scenario where after 21 days, we're going to go back again to having, you know, the restrictions back? Joy.
I'm sorry, Linda. There's a time there your mic went off, so we didn't quite catch your question. Would you mind repeating it?
All right. Well, not a problem. We're on that particular issue where we're discussing the COVID-19 and how much it has hit different counties and also different government offices and also just other private offices and sectors. And speaking of the counties, the question then is, they had been left with the burden of ensuring that we are successful in the fight of COVID-19. Remember, 300 beds capacity for every other county. But as it stands today, almost all the counties have registered numbers of COVID-19 cases. Where does it place us? Are we looking at a scenario where 21 days after we'll go back to where we are, or even worse, to a total lockdown?
I think the president warned us of this. Remember the first time when we were expecting him to open the country up, and we sent him all this manner of love notes, but at the end of the day, he ended up giving us an extra 30 days. Mm-hmm. During that time, he was very categorical.
Yeah.
And if I heard him correctly, he said, I would want to give you what you're asking, but mm-hmm. you're simply not ready.
Yeah.
County governments, can you please get ready? And he gave them that 30 days window to sort of get prepared for this.
Mm.
So the fact that the counties are feeling unprepared, in my opinion, is not unfair on them because of two major reasons. One, health is a devolved function.
Yeah.
So they ought to have been investing in health all along anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So this is not a time to start making excuses. It's a time to step up and do that which you are established to do.
Yeah.
Then secondly, because of the investment that has gone into COVID and the support from government so far, even the counties that felt that they were ill prepared had a chance to not only get better prepared, mm-hmm. but you also have the fallback position of the COVID Emergency Response Fund
yeah.
that are able to make emergency intervention in terms of funding or anything that you need to help you get better prepared. Mm-hmm. Why is this critical? It is because what you're seeing now, most of the counties already have a case or two or 10 of COVID that they're dealing with.
Yeah.
Now the rubber has met the road. And the minister has been very categorical in saying, don't think that Nairobi is a fallback. Mm. If anything happens, you deal with it within your counties.
Within your
so as far as I'm concerned, it's a very harsh litmus test, but it's a litmus test nonetheless mm-hmm. of whether or not our governors are serious and capable
yeah.
of dealing with the people that they have in their counties and taking care of them as far as the health function is concerned.
Mm-hmm. All right. I mean, and you raise a pertinent point, too, and of course, just taking us back to the 6th of June, when President Uhuru Kenyatta said that he was not going to open or is not going to ease restrictions because we are not ready. And also on his last address, that is the 6th of July, he argued that, yes, we had not met the threshold. We were not ready just yet. And if we were, then, of course, there was a lot of work that would couple up us, you know, easing the restrictions. Clearly, would you want to say that the president was right in making this decision moving forward, acknowledging also the fact that, yes, we were not ready as of or as per the reducible minimums that were supposed to be achieved? Clearly, across all the counties, the bed capacity to start with was not up to par.
Yeah. You know where we have reached now? We are past the time when we were trying to figure this thing out.
Yeah.
Now, as the ministry officials have told us, we are already in the community stage when we are spreading the virus within the community.
Yeah.
Because that's where we are, we do not have a choice in terms of going back to a total lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
It's futile at this point.
Yeah.
The time for lockdown is when the infections are so localized that you can contain them in a certain area.
Mm-hmm.
Once it has gone community, it's of no use anymore. So the way people are keeping saying, oh, the numbers will rise to a level where the president will lock us down again, that's not going to happen
yeah.
unless it gets to very topic levels.
Mm-hmm.
Where we have reached is where the president indicated. Personal responsibility. I don't think there's a choice in that.
Yeah.
You have to be responsible for wearing your mask correctly,
mm-hmm.
keeping social distance correctly, taking care of your people correctly.
Yeah.
And we have seen now we've reached a place where we are not testing everybody.
Mm-hmm.
We're only testing those who present with symptoms. So even the luxury of seeing people coming to camp at your local shopping center offering voluntary tests, we are past that mark now.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because the reagents are very expensive and very scarce. So we can't do that. We are past.
But just how effective are these, let me just ask you, just how effective are these measures, especially when you look at the fact that when we put them on board, we still had issues of grappling and trying to reduce the numbers. Instead, the numbers are going high by the day, even if we struggle to do this. And even worse, we look at case studies or case examples like Tanzania the other day saying that, you know, we're not going to go by all these measures that are being upheld across different parts of the world, but we are going to focus much on, you know, just trying to pray and see to it that we're able to function as a country as expected. And true to it, they have been doing very well. We and all crossing fingers that indeed this is going to be the case all through. I mean, when you look at such a scenario, it begs the question as to how much you know, these measures go handy in terms of ensuring that we are able to deal with this, because it is pointless to put people through, you know, the things that are so unusual, things that they are not used to. Yet this in huge way does not come in handy to address the aspect of the spread or to reduce the spread, Joy. So the biggest question is just how much are these measures effective?
These measures have been shown to be the only measures that will keep us safe. It's not what we are used to, but it's our new normal.
Yeah.
There's no going back, for example, from wearing masks
mm-hmm.
for the next at least 2 years. This is going to be our everyday.
But you want your new normal, Joy. Don't you want your new normal to be effective? Don't you want, you know, to get something new and you clearly see the results of getting this new? You know, you get a new dress and you look good on it. Instead of getting a new dress and you're not looking good on it.
The science has shown us that that is what is effective.
Yeah.
There's no vaccine and there's no real treatment. You're only treating the symptoms until hopefully your body is strong enough to fight back mm-hmm. the infection. The only way to keep droplets from getting to your neighbors and keeping them safe yeah. is by wearing a mask. So in case you're infectious, you don't give other people. Mm-hmm. The only way to keep safe from other people infecting you is to maintain social distance from them.
But that is not going to be the case with the flights that we are expecting. And actually, even the flights that we witnessed, you know, setting off yesterday. So, I mean, in as much as we would say that, there's a lot of doublespeak and there's a lot of, you know, unrealistic activities happening, revolving around the aspect of social distancing.
No, in the flights, wearing masks is mandatory.
Yes.
This is very critical because wearing masks means everybody's droplets remains with them. So they don't spread out as much as possible. Is it 100% safe? No. But is it better than nothing?
Yes.
And that is the new reality. Remember when they were being told social distancing in flights and they said, look, if we do that, then our flights don't become cost effective.
Yeah.
And we have to pass that cost on to the passengers who are already in a financially dire situation.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to come to a place where we make some compromises. Now, one of the things that people are advised to do is assess your risk so that you know, for example, if I am diabetic or if I am hypertensive or I'm recovering from cancer treatment or I have HIV and my viral load is very high, would I get into a flight? The answer is no, because yeah. that is a high risk zone. So we are coming to a place where now that back to my point about personal responsibility, it is you to weigh and see what I stand to lose and what I stand to benefit. Does it make it worth it? And then you see how you proceed forward. Mm-hmm. So like for you to make the decision to go to work today, it was a cost benefit analysis because every time you leave the house, you're entering into quote unquote a risky situation. But that's what I'm saying, because there are things we know that help. We know that masks help. Are they 100%? No.
Mm-hmm.
But if everybody is wearing one, there's less pathogen in the air.
Yeah.
So that's a good thing. We know social distancing works because so far we've been told it is not yet quite airborne. It can be airborne, but it's not quite airborne.
Mm-hmm.
So it is mostly droplets. So if you're too far for the droplets to land on you, then you're relatively safe. But as you said, also, they'll come to a place where people will have to see somebody suffering from COVID up close
mm-hmm.
for them to sort of believe that this thing works. Or they'll have to get it themselves
mm-hmm.
because there's a lot of personal responsibility that's not being taken because people are still in that denial. Is this thing real? Is it not real? Is it a scam? Is it not a scam? So that is complicating issues.
Mm-hmm.
But the science so far is not very faulty.
All right.
Those are the things that can help. It's the masks, the social distancing, the washing your hands frequently, the keeping your hands away from your face, nose and eyes as much as you can. That's what's working. So that's all we have to work with.
All right. And, you know, interestingly, I don't know, I just feel like I would want to hear your take on this, on whether you think indeed this is effective. The SMS line and, of course, the numbers to call rolling down on your screen, or drop us a message on the social media pages at TV47 at Linda_Alela. That is on Twitter, or Morning Cafe. That is hashtag Morning Cafe. And I don't know. I just don't know how effective this has been for you or whether you feel this is effective. And now that Joy brings aboard a very pertinent aspect, that, you know, we ask this question: do you know a person who has COVID-19? And I think that is that has been the aspect of denial. Most of the Kenyans arguing that maybe this is a hoax. There's probably nobody with this case. But it looks like it is turning from that narrative to a different narrative altogether. Looking at the numbers that we are having today and looking at the cases that are being registered in government entities, in private entities, in different offices, Pumwani being amongst the latest, Treasury, Huduma Center, State House itself has recorded a number, Parliament has recorded a number at least. So I guess we're running from that point where we'll stop saying that I do not know anyone who has COVID-19 to a point where we'll say, at least I know a person who has COVID-19. Where does this place us?
You know, it is very unfortunate, especially for what you're pointing out, government offices and stuff, because while the rest of us were locked down and were told to stay away, some government offices were kept open of necessity.
Yeah.
Some services had to keep rolling on. And unfortunately, in that early season, it's not just the Kenyans who are skeptical. Even some of the government officials were skeptical and insisted that the people have to turn up to work. I know for a fact, for lawyers, we insisted that the courts have to reopen. We want to carry on with our cases. Our clients are in dire straits. People are being auctioned. So there's a push generally to keep government open. And unfortunately, that's why you're seeing, I've seen in the OP, in the PSC, we've seen in various government institutions where you've got high numbers in a place like Pumwani, where you've got such high numbers of people who are essential services, but were not well protected while they were offering the essential services. Now, lesson learned, we are losing those essential services while we help the people to recover from that. So you are right, we're getting to a level where the denial is making us pay a price for it. Because there are people who maybe felt when they're in the office, they're with colleagues, they're safe, they wore the chin guard rather than the face mask. So it was worn over here. And now maybe one of them is positive and is thinking, oh, I should have kept that mask on properly the whole time. It's one of those things where sometimes experience, though an expensive teacher, is really the best teacher. But not just that. One thing I want to point out is that we have seen in Kenya, most of our cases are asymptomatic. They don't display any symptoms or display very mild symptoms. That's an encouragement, because even with the high positives, we are sure that we shall have high recoveries, because that's been our trend so far. The other thing we can encourage ourselves with is that now we know more about the virus than 120 days ago when we first had it in Kenya. The doctors know better what to do. They have a little bit of experience and they know who are the high risk patients. The other thing we do know is that what you can take, you can do, take care of yourself at home. The Ministry of Health has released these guidelines of what you can do in the house as Linda to help yourself or to help a relative who has COVID-19. So because of that element of we have better understanding and better control, it gives us a measure of comfort that even if I'm told I'm positive, it's not, oh, I'm positive. It is a matter of, okay, so now this is what I need to do. I need to get my own separate utensils, keep distance away from my children. I can be around them, but they can't come into my room. We already have an idea of what we can do. And that level of information gives us control. So what I would like to see is for MOH now to stop with the numbers. There's so many, we get it. Now, can we get, we all get it. Can we get to the place where now you're telling us, this is what you do. This is how you handle it. This is what you look out for. If you experience these symptoms, call the hospital and warn them that you're coming so that they prepare, they take care of themselves and prepare to receive you. That's where we should reach. That's why the SMS number, that rapid response is important. We don't want people coming in their white clothes, traumatizing people in the community, picking people up. Just tell me, call your local hospital, tell them I'm having difficulty breathing. My temperature is 38.5. I'm coming in a car, registered this, and I'll be at this. So that, therefore, one, and let us handle this thing differently so that everybody feels they're in control of the situation. Like HIV, like TB, we can handle this. We can.
Okay, well, we wish us nothing but the best as we struggle and grapple to address this, yes?
Yes, we will make it.
We will, yeah? Let's be positive over that. At least for once, it's good to have a speck of positivity amid all these tough times. And now bringing us to a different topic altogether, we're still trying to get a hold of Steve Kijana. But meanwhile, we proceed with Joy as I continue calling upon you to interact with us. Of course, the numbers rolling down on your screen or our social media platforms, TV47, that is at TV47 on Twitter, at Linda_Alela, TV47 Facebook, and you can as well stream live on YouTube as you give us your take. And we come back to Nairobi County alone. Governor Mike Sonko now spoils for war with NMS General. And it's quite a power struggle in Nairobi. If it's not with the governor and general body, then it is with the speaker and the majority leaders and the members of the county assembly and the MCS, you know, of course, they're the members of the county assembly. And it is just terrible to witness. And it leaves us asking, where is left, or what is left of the capital city of the country? What is left of devolution as it stands? What is left of the people of Nairobi who are staring at the leadership for more and more of developments in their cups?
When we were in the run-up to the 2010 referendum,
yeah,
I was in the no campaign. And one of the things that we're saying in the no campaign was the way our counties had been structured, they had been made too small to remain independent and economically viable. Now, what that does is that there's always a starvation of resources,
mm-hmm,
because you're not able to marshal enough resources to keep yourself going. Now, Nairobi was one of the counties that did not have that problem,
mm-hmm,
because we were the seat of business, we were the seat of government. And so in terms of marshalling resources to support ourselves, we were generating resources to put back in the exchequer,
mm-hmm,
that now was coming back in as county allocations. So there was that notion that Nairobi was a super county, for lack of a better word.
Right, yeah.
Now, fast forward to what you have in BBI recommendations. And one of them is that Nairobi shouldn't be treated as a regular county. It should be treated as a super county, such that the functions are separated, where you have the administrative functions handled by the county government. So you elect your ward reps and the who, and they run basically what happens in the estates, for lack of a better word.
Mm-hmm.
But what happens in terms of the capital city and the business side and the UN international sort of side, that is run separately by,
yeah,
a Nairobi Metropolitan Services kind of thing. So what we are seeing now is that precipitation. You know, it's come to a place where the levels are finding themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And so that struggle, that separation, because I would predict that even if we don't change our constitution, having a sort of NMS in the office of the president,
mm-hmm,
will always ensure that there are certain services that do not slacken because they are not at the mercy of the MCA or the county government. So, for example, if something like what is in Kirinyaga happens in Nairobi,
mm-hmm,
and the MCAs are always torpedoing the governor's agenda,
yeah,
can you imagine no roads? No services would happen simply because of the battles at City Hall.
Mm.
Now with having NMS, you have got something that offers services over and above the regular politics of the day.
Mm-hmm.
But back to your question, where does that leave devolution? Is this a good thing for devolution? I would say not,
mm-hmm,
because Kenyans bothered to actually vote for a governor.
Yeah.
And watching our governor yesterday before the Senate, listening to him talk, he's such a frustrated gentleman that you look and you're thinking, oh no, you cannot bear the big title of governor of Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, you have no office to function from. You have been chased away from even your private office.
Yeah.
We've gotten to a place where you're basically sitting at home, earning a salary for nothing. Do Kenyans deserve that? Did Nairobi people deserve that?
Yeah.
And I'd wager Sonko has his stronghold in Nairobi. Even if he stood as an independent in the next election, we may be sure to still end up with Governor Sonko.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe there was wisdom in trying to find a way of working with the elected officials rather than the complete divorce, mm-hmm, from the elected officials.
Mm-hmm.
But that said, we cannot forget why we are here. Governor Sonko was facing an impeachment.
Yeah.
He decided not to have a deputy so that he's almost not impeachable. He thought he was being clever,
mm-hmm,
but he got to a place where his back was against the wall.
Yeah.
He himself signed the deed to hand over these functions to the national government. And we've seen a few of the other counties where some governors have handed over some functions to the national government.
Mm.
It's not a good thing for devolution because there was a reason why we devolved to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
I would we have a bigger discussion about maybe time has come for us to merge some counties so they become bigger, mm-hmm, and more efficient. Maybe a conversation needs to be had about maybe reducing some of the functions if we can't increase the money, because money must follow function. If that can't happen, reduce the duty so that what the counties have,
yeah,
they can actually handle.
Mm-hmm.
So this is, it's a good study case. And I will challenge some of the guys who are still in university in final year. Write a thesis, write a dissertation about what's happening in Nairobi.
Yeah.
Let's study it a little bit more. The scholars, let's chambua this thing. Because right now Nairobi is like, for lack of a better word, we are a petri dish in a lab.
Mm.
We're just waiting to see what unfolds, what cultures actually grow in our colony of infection.
Yeah. Well, but anyway, looking at that, looks like amid all this, there's been, lots of accolades are directed towards NMS in how it has handled this. Do you suppose that it is doing the right thing, or is just because there's something to compare it to, and whatever it is that it's being compared to has performed terribly, such that, you know, whatever it is that they can offer, in as much as maybe it's not enough or there's more that can be offered, we still look at that as something positive?
No, I don't think NMS has done anything so extraordinary that we need to sort of compare them to the county government and say the county government was a total failure.
Yeah. No?
I live in Rungai, so I'm basically in Kajiado County.
Yes.
But I function a lot from Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
And I function a lot from the estates because I grew up in Eastlands.
Yeah.
And there are places where we saw a lot of work that the county government did in building the roads in the estates and rehabilitating those and putting up stuff. So there's something that the county government was doing. So it's not like there's absolutely nothing happening.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the same thing that you're seeing with NMS. They're focusing mainly on industrial area in the CBD, the water project now they're running in the slums. So they're sort of delivering services to the people, but they're also taking care of the macros.
Mm-hmm.
What I see NMS good for is the fact that they don't have the shackles or the weight of having to deal with the politics of running the city.
Yeah.
Because they're directly under the office of the president.
Mm-hmm.
So what that does, it gives them the independence to be able to say, right, we need to dig boreholes.
Mm-hmm.
There's no need of whining and dining your MCAs. There's no need of trying to pass a budget or a vote. It's a matter of what they were allocated. Is it enough to do it? Yes. Is it in the budget? Yes. So they go ahead and do it.
Mm-hmm.
That is very helpful. The other thing the NMS helps us with is, remember, this is where you've got a UN headquarters. It's the only one in Africa that you have a proper UN headquarters. We have got many members of our diplomatic corps who live in Nairobi and work from Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
We have a sizable NGO community, international NGOs, who are headquartered in Nairobi from across even the African region or the Eastern, Central, and Southern African region.
Yeah.
So there are those services that cannot slip up for the sake of that particular demographic.
Mm-hmm.
And so NMS is important for those, because if there are places where there's a rapid response needed, now NMS can do it.
Mm-hmm.
Places where the governor would have tried to play politics with it, now there's no for playing politics.
Mm-hmm.
The general is working under his commander-in-chief. So he has direct duty to the president to deliver on the same.
Okay.
So
well,
there's what NMS has to salvage. And it's excellent in my opinion. So it's not versus what the county is doing, no. It's what are they accomplishing? That's what they were put up to accomplish.
Mm-hmm.
To just clean up Nairobi and make it working again while the politics sorts itself out.
Mm. All right. So while I was traversing the streets of Nairobi the other day, you know, amidst all these talks of the case ongoing, that was the day before yesterday, there were lots of, you know, people on borders. And, you know, carrying like, you see one Buddha Buddha carrying like 3-4 people, and they were all out there. And the talk on ground was that, yes, these were Sonko supporters. I'm telling you, hundreds and hundreds of Kenyans. And it got me asking myself, really, is this the kind of support that we want, or our leaders really want and yearn for us so that they can capture that attention? And I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but I'm looking at it at this time of COVID-19, where, of course, we're talking about how important space or social distance is. We're talking about how much it is important to uphold the regulations that have been put on board. But I can tell you that that was violated to the maximum. And I've not heard of any arrests. And I've not heard of any complaints in regards to the same. And before we even get to the aspect of COVID-19, it has violated the aspect of, you know, how many people are supposed to be carried on a border or a motorcycle or a motorbike. And it got me asking myself, as a leader, do you even stand and look at that and look at the people violating the rules in the name of they are supporting you? And it's such a common thing.
Is that when it comes to politics, Kenyans are rarely logical.
Mm-hmm.
They don't think through the consequences of their actions.
Yeah.
Like you said, if you think about the COVID season, that alone should have been enough to make people not behave in a certain manner.
Yeah.
But Kenyan politicians are used to these optics. Think about it. Every time a governor, not even a governor, a politician is going to, for example, Integrity Center because they've been summoned.
Mm-hmm.
You always see this. You saw it with Waigoro, you saw it with Sonko, you saw it with Kidero.
Mm-hmm.
But do you know one day the rubber meets the road and you end up in court?
Yeah.
And when you go to court, You can't go in border border riders, you cannot mobilize. In such a situation, the police don't have much that they can do because it's a mob.
Yeah.
So there's only so much as a police officer that you can try to do. And it's not a rational mob. Mm-hmm. It's a mob that has been charged. It has been mobilized.
Yeah.
So if you try to intervene and say, you guys, why are you three on a motorbike? You can imagine what would happen to that poor policeman.
Mm-hmm.
So a policeman has to also think about him, his family, and say, you know what? That's not my fight. That's not my battle. And just take a step back.
Yeah.
But that underscores what we were talking about earlier, the issue of personal responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
You can be sure amongst there, if there was one or two people who were early COVID cases that they didn't even know, or maybe they knew and they ignored,
mm-hmm.
how many people did they infect in that season that they were together?
Yeah.
At the end of the day, do a cost-benefit analysis. What has it helped Governor Sonkowitz? Is he out of trouble? No. Who cares about those optics anymore?
Mm-hmm.
We are already wise to the fact that, you know what, when it comes to corruption, you're carrying your own cross.
Yeah.
You can have as many people go with you. Kidero used to draw some of the largest crowds.
Mm.
Even he himself would have difficulty trying to get into Integrity Center because it's jam-packed. But when he's standing in court today, he's there with his lawyer. No one else is standing up.
Mm-hmm.
So when the day of reckoning comes, all those optics will be for absolutely nothing. It will have served absolutely no purpose. But Kenyans have endangered their lives. They have broken the law. They have flouted the law. And that is where treating Nairobi maybe as a super county might kill some of the excitement of being governor.
Mm.
Such that, you know, if you're governor, you try and just maintain your turf, because, you know, if you don't, there's an alternative that people have that is not you.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm hoping Governor Sonko also learns from this. In case he runs for re-election, that he will do things different the second time around.
All right.
But so this one, I think he's already lost the plot. There's no salvation this time round. He's already too far gone, and as a leader, he's already ceded so much ground that I don't see him coming back to the stature of the governor of Nairobi that we had before when he was just elected.
But you still feel like he has a political lifeline?
He does. He is very popular in Nairobi, incredibly so, as unbelievable as that seems.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying, if he even decided to run as an independent, Sonko is the type of politician who there's a constituency that he has activated that even without us middle class elite little, you know, bougie people, that he has a base that actually appreciate and love him almost to fanatical levels.
Mm-hmm.
So he might stand and even actually pull a very major upset. Mm-hmm. However, if you're running and you're running to what purpose, it won't help. And if the investigations lead to some criminal charges, he might be unable to run if he's convicted, like we saw with the MP Sirisia.
Mm-hmm.
So that aspect might keep you from running. But if he does run, Sonko has still a very strong support base among the voters. It does.
All right. Well, and as we talk so much about Sonko, we cannot go without looking at, you know, the rest of the leadership in Nairobi. And, you know, they've been treating us to lots of drama. The MCA's drama day in, day out. Beatrice Elachi with the drama, of course, against her by the MCA's day in, day out. And this, in a way, also has stalled the project, especially for the county assembly, for the wards, for that matter. Because you see also there's been an issue on approving of the budget, and there's been an issue on salaries of the members of the county assembly themselves. There's been an issue of fights and everything. And, you know, it's dangerous, as we rightfully put it, because in the event that Sonko is not there, then, of course, the only person that we have is Beatrice Elachi to take up the seat of the governor. But again, also, her office has been dealt a blow in numerous times, and, you know, with lots of battles and drama, like I say. I mean, just how do we get these ones in order, in as much as we have Badi, who's now said to be doing what it is that is expected for the people of Nairobi?
You know, for even as much as Kenyans like knocking down the law and the fan of lawyers, we don't take it personally, but there's a reason why the law exists, because it gives us predictability.
Yeah.
It gives us a determinant path that we can follow.
Yeah.
And Nairobi, that's what we are failing to adhere to. We have certain things that we must have in place.
Yeah.
They were put there for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
And we choose to just simply ignore them. And so you want to change leadership, put back leadership, make this ungovernable for that one, make this ungovernable for that one. And we let politics take over from where the law, the standing orders, the rules of engagement have established.
Yeah.
And that's when you end up in trouble, especially for government. That's why those are memos that are written from the PSC's office and circulars and things like that. Those things are so critical. It's because they give us predictability on what we are supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
Do you like the people you work with? Maybe not all the time.
Yeah.
Do you have to work with them? Probably you have to. How do you engage them? If you can't have a cordial relationship, at least have a professional one.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what Nairobi has been failing. We've seen coups, like when for example, when they're trying to get Senator Lachi out the first time.
Yeah.
It was completely unprocedural. They threw out the rule book and just did things willy-nilly. Now, when Senator Lachi now is more powerful again and she starts doing the same,
mm-hmm.
we start crying foul because the rules have not been followed. There's a reason why
mm-hmm.
rules and laws and procedures exist. And Nairobi, like I said, somebody needs to study Nairobi, because we have come to a place where we tore up the rule book. We had a governor who decided governing without a deputy against the rule book. We had a county assembly that decided they were law unto themselves throughout the rule book.
Mm-hmm.
We have political party formations that sometimes don't stick to the norms and the culture that has been established in houses against the rule book. Now we've come to a place where we are in free fall.
Yeah.
And that's what we're witnessing in Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a good thing for the people of Nairobi. And that's why NMS is such a rescue for the people of Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
But politically, we're in a shambles. And we need to come to a place where our elected leaders hit the reset button, call a ceasefire, stop all the machinations, stop
mm-hmm.
calling from outside help, you know, going to party headquarters instead of dealing with things on the floor of the house. Let's get to a place where
all right.
we follow the rule
uh-huh.
and we make it work.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and you know, still on the same point, we cross over to a different county, and you know, to a governor who's one would consider, you know, as one who's been cut from the same cloth, of course, with the likes of Sonko, looking at the events and how they have shaped, and also how much this is an undoing to the people of that particular county, and that is Kirinyaga County. And of course, the latest, which is more or less like a blow, or considered as a blow to Waiguru, but equally a blow to the people of Kirinyaga, and the budget was shot down. That is the budget of course, Kirinyaga, and this was done by the MCAs who voted to go against that, and you know, not approving the 2020-2021 budget. While it might look like it's a battle against Waiguru or a shot on Waiguru, it's obviously an undoing to the people of Kirinyaga. Joy?
Yes.
Yes, I'm saying,
I'm
while
sorry,
it might look like it's
a
short.
Gone off a little bit.
All right.
It's
yes.
Just the last, but I think let me go back to the bit that I had heard.
Yes.
Governor Waiguru is not cut from the same cloth as Governor Sonko, I think.
Yeah.
If you're looking at Waiguru, compare her to Governor Wambora or Samboja or Kivutha Kibwana.
Who survived? The few
who not just survived, uh-huh. or who had these wars and these tangles with the MCAs.
Okay.
And so we have to come to a place where we understand that if you're going to be a governor, you're an elected official.
Mm-hmm.
And the people that you're working with are also elected officials.
Yeah.
If you don't find a happy balance, then you end up with the troubles that Governor Waiguru is facing now.
Mm-hmm.
Because you could be a governor in name, but if the house that is supposed to help you govern frustrates your every effort, you will get nothing done.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what she's learning now.
Mm.
Remember, we had a discussion on this show earlier, and I pointed out, she even with a victory at the Senate, she has to find a way to bridge that gap with her MCAs.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, the rest of her term will be very frustrated. Remember, Governor Wambora, the first term, he was fighting with his MCAs almost on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
He won all the legal tussles, but Embu was in a complete standstill, basically. Not much happened in his first term.
Mm-hmm.
His second term has been a little bit more settled, and so he's getting something done. Same thing with Kivutha Kibwana. He got to a place where he almost called for the dissolution of the county, Makueni County at that time, because the wrangles had gotten to a place where there was a complete standoff.
Yeah.
Second time around, he has done it different. He has tried to keep the MCAs close and keep the peace,
mm-hmm.
even while he maintains his principles. That's something that Governor of Kirinyaga must discover.
Yeah.
She must find a way of getting the MCAs back in her corner.
Mm-hmm.
This is something that will not be easy to do, because I suspect there's been a lot of bad blood between herself and the MCAs. But it's just a matter of one step at a time. The arm twisting and the strong arm politics will not get them, either of them, very far. Because the MCAs are just as stuck as she is. Because, you know, you can't fill a basket one person without getting stuck in the process yourself. So they also need to find a way of making it work. Others, even what they're trying to champion of, we want the money to go to the ward projects and not to the mega projects in the county. Even that won't happen because she simply won't sign off. They won't pay the people doing the services. The people will withdraw their services. Before long, they will all be checkmate. So for the sake of the service to the Kirinyaga people, Governor Waiguru and her MCAs must find a working relationship.
But let's just be honest with this. You know, in as much as there's that need to find a working relationship, remember, these are the very MCAs that talked of impeaching her, and they had their grounds, and according to them, their grounds held, you know, in a good word, or enough, of course, so to speak, to proceed and impeach her. And according to them, they feel like, you know, justice is not being done to the people of Kirinyaga. How do you tweak or twist the mind of these people to a point whereby they're going to say, it's okay, well, let's get down, let's focus on developing Kirinyaga for the people of the county? And I mean, it brings me to the question also on where exactly is the missing link, especially when you look at what, of course, was given by the Senate as verdict, and equally what was given by the county assembly as their own verdict. Of course, these two discrepancies or two different verdicts, but then again, they leave the people of Kirinyaga somewhere in between, in limbo. So in as much as they would want to work together or in tandem with Anne Waiguru, is it justice to the people?
You know, the Senate process was inquisitorial. It was just finding out, was there merit in what was going on or not? And that's why the hearing didn't have quite the threshold of a court proceeding, but just was taking a second look at what has been alleged.
Joy, allow me to cut you short. Let's pick this phone call. Let's pick this phone call from Peter from Gikuyu. Let's get to hear what he has to say in regards to the same. Good morning, Peter. Peter, good morning. Thank you for calling in, huh?
Hello.
Yes, Peter.
Nataka kuchangia.
Ndio. Tafadhali endelea.
Sababu kunaongea ya Waiguru.
Ndio.
Unaita Songo.
Ndio.
Amekuwa ame Songo alikuwa mtakuwa hata deputy la CEO au kwa nenda wa kata.
Right. Well, asante sana.
Hello.
Ndio nakusikia.
Sasa tunakwambia sasa.
Ndio.
Hakuna mtu anafanya kazi Kenya hii. Kama Songo, mtu huyu ameweka hata anataka ameweka na Nairobi ameweka Kibera. Lakini sasa tunaenda tunaambiwa. Kuna watu wakaambia wewe kwa nini mambo kama hiyo wasema sisi. Songo anafanya hii anafanya.
Yeah. Unapozungumzia kuharibia, Peter, labda ningependa nijue, unafikiria ni nani anaweza kuwa anataka au ana kiu ya kumharibia mtu kama Waiguru au kiu ya kumharibia mtu kama Sonko wakati huu?
Mtu amefanya mambo kazi mzuri asiviwe.
Ndiyo.
Kama amefanya kazi kama hiyo mambo ya hiyo kitu kia ametengeneza vitu ya sanitizer Kibera kila mahali tumeharibiwa. Bwana watu wangasije wacha hiyo mambo waseme. Hii amefanya, hii amefanya, kila saa yote tutafanya assassination.
All right, maoni mazuri hapo. Ndio.
Hata mangali yake inasaidia watu hata na kukunywa maji kule. Na hata hakuna mtu yule anaona vile anafanya. Sasa hizi mambo ya aina gani?
Aha. Asante sana Peter. Wacha tusikie maoni ya yule ambaye tuko naye kwenye studio ambaye ni Joy Mdivo. Na Joy, coming back to you, of course, as you expound some more on what you were talking about before we distracted your line of thought to pick that phone call. I mean, also coming, you know, very pertinent point right here in regards to the witch hunt activities that would happen, and we know how politics plays about. And the people in Awe resonate so much so to these governors. You know, for instance, they say, of course, they've received so much from the Sonko rescue team. And we saw the people of Kirinyaga proceeding to vote Governor Anne Waiguru amid all the talks of course, matters corruption or the NYS scandal and so much so. So in as much as there's this side of the members of the county assembly, this side of the Senate, this side of matters politics, there's also that side of the people. And well, as Peter says, according to him, this is just sheer witch hunt.
Yes, and that underscores the point that we made earlier.
Yeah.
That in this particular situation, if the governor ran for a second term, he probably would still win. And so the national government, in what they're doing now, mm-hmm. have to have that in their side view mirror. That, you know what, this gentleman, we may not be done with him yet. Mm. He may still come back again. Or a gentleman with that persuasion. But there's a point that you have made that is very important, we should not lose it, mm-hmm. is that governors are elected by people, and the people who elect governors believe in them, and they support them, mm-hmm. and they follow them, because they own them. So if somebody comes from, DOD,
yeah.
and they are doing an excellent job, they don't know that guy from Adam, mm-hmm. they don't know where he came from, they don't know who gave him the mandate, but they feel like they give the governor the mandate, mm-hmm. and they feel that the governor is my representative. And so in Nairobi, you'll find a lot of sympathy for Governor Sonko from some quarters.
Yeah.
Kirinyaga is a bit different because it's the people who are sort of, the people's representatives are sort of turning against mm-hmm. their other. So it's elected officials versus elected officials.
Yeah.
Now that's different because you may find that even on the ground, the popularity of Governor Waiguru may have shifted because of that particular dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why it's important for a consensus to be found.
Yeah.
Because impeaching a governor is not as easy as making an impeachment motion and taking it to the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
No one has ever succeeded on that score apart from what we saw for the Kiambu governor.
Kiambu, yeah.
And that was arguably a public lynching.
Mm-hmm.
There wasn't really a Senate hearing. I mean, there was no rule book.
Yeah.
It was he must go and Wetutu went. And so that is not a good precedent to set in terms of taking a matter to the Senate,
mm-hmm.
because that was a blot in the process, if you ask me. But impeaching a governor is not easy, and there's a reason why it's not easy.
Yeah.
It's because the threshold has been set very high.
Mm-hmm.
What recourse do they have? If they have enough dossier, then submit it to a court of law.
Yeah.
Because unlike the Senate committee that has got 10 days and are only kept at the inquisitorial state,
mm-hmm.
if you take the matter to court and the evidence is tested for its veracity, its effectiveness, and they say that, you know what, this is good evidence, we can convict on this,
mm-hmm.
then you are successful, even if not in removing them from office, but in barring them from running for office. And so that actually delivers something to your people.
Yeah.
But having the drama and the sideshows, at the end of the day, it's vile Waswahili walisema, fahali wawili wakipigana,
mm-hmm.
anayeumia ni nyasi. And
yeah.
right now it's the people who are suffering because when you filibuster the governor,
mm-hmm.
when you block her budget, then she also will not reciprocate when you're taking your ward-friendly budgets. At the end of the day, neither of you look good.
Mm-hmm.
So for Kirinyaga, there's definitely a need to change tact.
Mm-hmm.
There is need to build bridges amongst them. She says she's a BPA proponent. Can she start by building the bridges between herself and her county assembly? Because without that, her legacy as a governor is a shambles, technically. Mm-hmm.
All right. Mm-hmm. Well, of course, we wait to see what happens in this and how best Waiguru is able to work with the members of the county assembly, so at least mm-hmm. the people of Kirinyaga are able to get the service, because constitutionally she is there, she's in office. The only way that they can work is if they agree to work together, because if they keep these frustrations on, then obviously, like you've said, it is the people who are going to suffer. Reminds us of what should have happened, of course, on Angilu's talk of matters impeachment. And well, I don't know what really played out. That's an interesting one for another day. I'm sure you must have seen what has been going around, especially with the memes and the talks on ground. It is indeed a funny affair for that matter. So yes, we see whether
they may have reached an out of assembly settlement, but they had to blame someone or something.
Yeah.
And it's better you blame somebody who cannot answer back. You say it was it was the comedy. For lack of a better word.
It was, for sure, honestly.
Good comic relief. And if it was true,
Gilo must be a very lucky lady.
We need to get the number. Yeah. We need to get the number of that juju man.
Yeah.
May need it for us Arsenal fans, may need his services soon.
All right, well, that's an interesting analogy out there. And I think on that one, we're not even going to touch anything. We just wait to see what will come up in terms of development. And as towards the last laps, the House committees were shuffled. And of course, the names were tabled as of yesterday. And this is being considered as something that will work in favor of the BBI. What do you make of that?
It is true, because you remember earlier when there was a lot of opposition to some of the composition, especially of the JLAC and the one for finance.
Yeah.
The main reason that Honorable Mbadi was putting forward was some of these people are not supportive of the BBI process, and they might torpedo the BBI process if they're in such powerful committees.
Yeah.
And that's why you see they've been relegated to the catering committees and the other are not so critical committees of the House.
Mm-hmm.
However, that said, we also have to look at the dynamics of what this means for Jubilee as a party.
Yeah.
They are the ruling party, but right now you get the distinct impression that ODM is the ruling party, because they're basically calling the shots. Remember when Amos Kimunya first came out very strongly and said, you know what, this is the list and that is it.
Yeah.
As majority leader, he should be able to put down his foot on that. But for the minority leader to come in, have a meeting with him, and the next thing you see is everything has been turned to what the minority leader wanted.
Once,
it shows you the immense influence that ODM has on the floor right now.
Yeah.
But back to your question about BBI, that is important, because what I see in my crystal ball is that COVID has complicated the issue of a referendum.
Mm-hmm.
It might not be very easy to pull a referendum with the health concerns being where they are.
Yeah.
We have had a little bit of bravado with the government offices, and you've seen where that has ended up, with a lot of infections in some of these areas.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think that our leaders are so insensitive as to put the lives of Kenyans at stake for the sake of an election.
Yeah.
What they would do is try and use parliament as a route of implementing a lot of the recommendations in the BBI.
Mm-hmm.
For that to happen, it means that the issues of BBI must make it on the order paper.
Yeah.
So you need to have a speaker and a majority leader who are working very closely to ensure that that happens.
Mm-hmm.
You need the money to implement some of those things. So you need people in finance and in the devolution committee to ensure that what needs to be disseminated to the counties is financed and is disseminated.
Mm-hmm.
You need laws that need to be changed to give some life into some of those recommendations. That is why being in the Justice and Legal Affairs Committee is very critical and very important.
Mm-hmm.
And so ODM has strategically placed themselves to ensure that they deliver for their end of the handshake. They're there to deliver for what Baba intended to come out of the BBI process.
Mm-hmm.
So they're there on assignment. It's not, yes, they're supportive of the president, but they're very mindful of their principle. And that's where they fought so hard to ensure that they have their lieutenants, and they brought their strong lieutenants into those positions. So it was very interesting to watch unfold. But that said, then it means the politicians have every intention of ensuring that BBI 2 is not only received, but as much of it as possible is implemented. And that's what this positioning tells me.
Mm-hmm. Well, these changes are, you know, constitutional and are allowed. Sometimes there are very many things that are looked into. In this case, the leader of majority, that is Amos Kimunya, and his minority counterpart, John Mbadi, said the changes have been made or were made because some former members had performed poorly, as of course, well as, you know, readiness of tabling of the BBI report. Before we get into the intrigues of the BBI report, do you suppose this was based on how good someone has performed or how bad this person has performed? And does it then probably justify why the likes of Aden Duale, who were considered to have been great performers on the previous docket, was probably the only one person who survived and got, you know, something that is worth in terms of the committees that are awarded and, you know, holding the Public Accounts Committee?
No, I don't think this has anything to do with performance. This is politics 101.
Yeah.
But if you listened to when they were trying to get Honorable Duale out and the submissions on the floor of the House, mm-hmm. you could tell it had nothing to do with competence.
Yeah.
When Honorable Ishungu was leaving the Budget Allocation Committee, his colleagues said, by the way, he was an excellent chairman, a very competent one,
yeah.
but it is what it is. This is politics 101. Mm. Of course, you must say face and say, so you know what, these guys are not performers. But that said, there are some I had not attended any committee meetings and whatnot. So I'm sure there are one or two there who are like rotten potatoes. It was not a loss anyway. But for majority of them, it was purely for it was for political expediency sake.
Mm.
So let me look at, for example, Honorable Sholei. She was muted to remain under Amos Kimunya's initial machinations.
Yeah.
But we know she's a strong lawyer. She's a very sound legal mind. Yeah. In the Jailer Committee, I happen to know that she worked very hard. And she's one of the two or three women leaders in the House who have been very strong and at the forefront of ensuring that the agenda keeps moving forward.
Yeah.
But that became a liability to, quote unquote, the BBA process,
mm-hmm.
such that they're like, you know what, we know she's a strong leader, but she hasn't been very supportive of the BBA process.
Yeah.
We fear she has enough strength to torpedo the process.
Mm-hmm.
So it had a lot to do with politics.
Yeah.
The competence or non-competence, not so much. But mm-hmm. that now tells you where they have been taken to serve. They need to take the same level of zeal and competence.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have been exemplary in JLAC, and then when you put in a less busy docket, you perform dismally.
Mm-hmm.
If they are performers, this is a chance for them to do just as well. And I like what Ishungu was saying yesterday,
mm-hmm.
assuring Junet that the quality of the mandazi, he will ensure that the quality of the mandazi does not fall. That's the attitude they need to go with, because none of them was bequeathed to these seats because they were performers to begin with.
Yeah.
It was almost a gift. Now that the gift has been taken away,
mm-hmm.
then you just suck it up and move on, because such is life.
All right. Mm-hmm. And sarcastically, as Junet also would say, that he sees a scenario where now Aden Duale will perform even better at this particular docket. We wait to see what happens in regards to the same. But of great interest was the Legal Affairs Committee, that is JLAC, that, one is expected to deal with the BBI. And according to the changes that were implemented, of course, it comprised of key allies of President Uhuru Kenyatta and Right Honorable Raila Odinga. Just how unfair or fair is this, in as much as, yes, this is a set on the hands of the key political leaders to make such decisions?
The only bit that I would say fair or unfair is the unseen hand of the executive in the process.
Yeah.
And not just the executive, but also of Honorable Raila in the process.
Yeah.
Ideally, this should be a function of the House.
Mm-hmm.
The members of the House need to put their strongest foot soldiers in. It's a matter of leadership.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's Jim Collins who said, is it Steve Covey? Anyway, mm-hmm. there's a leadership guru who said, you put the right people in the right space so that the right job is done.
Mm-hmm.
If you put the right people in the wrong spaces, then everything becomes a shambles.
Mm.
In this particular instance, if it was purely a function of Parliament, it would have been excellent. But the fact that there is the external hand soils it a little bit, but that does not take away the fact that the people you have in that committee are very strong legal minds and very strong personalities nonetheless. And so in terms of being robust and being alive to the factors that need to be come out, I'm sure it's going to be a very lively and efficient committee.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a loss, so to speak. It's not, look at who they replaced them.
Uh-huh.
No, these are people who, in their own right, have proved their own mettle.
Okay.
And I'm looking forward to a very robust JLAC.
Mm-hmm.
We've had a very robust JLAC. It's not like it's been lackluster.
Yeah.
But in terms of BBI and what is coming forward, these are people who can definitely move Kenya in a certain direction.
Mm-hmm.
The misfortune would be if they allow themselves to be captured such that they're not independent in their thinking and in their discussions and in whatnot. Because if the JLAC committee comes up with recommendations that are less than stellar, then the House will adopt them, maybe most probably without too much amendments, and the Kenyan again stands to suffer.
Mm-hmm.
But I know some of the members proposed, they're excellent advocates who I have immense respect for.
Yes.
And I think that their oath of office is just as important as the oath they took when they got into the House.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm hoping those two oaths will be a guiding light more than the politics of the day, that they will look at Kenya as patriots mm-hmm. and not as party members.
All right. And this comes at a time when President Uhuru Kenyatta and Raila Odinga are considering receiving the BBI final report, probably virtually or whichever way, of course, presented by the Garissa Senator Yusuf Haji Task Force. And looking at that and all these formations and all these changes that have been made, is it a sign or is it a message to Wanjiku that whether you're going to read the report or not, this one is sailing through?
I think when we had BBI one, that impression came through very strongly. Mm-hmm. And that is why in the validation process before the second BBI report, yeah. you saw many people, even those who had not participated in the process earlier, scrambling to make sure that they make their presentation or at least hand in a memorandum mm-hmm. because they realized, you know what, this thing looks like it's actually going to be pushed through. It's going to come to pass. And that's why as much as people were skeptical at the first time, yeah. I think many of them have come to the realization, you know what, this BBI thing is going to go through whether I participate or not. So I would rather participate than mm-hmm. ignore it. Mm-hmm. The misfortune now is that with the current situation, you will not have like the public participation that you'd have hoped in terms of interacting with the report.
Yeah.
Maybe that is a good thing because I think those BBI rallies were just, it was a bad show. It was not helping the national conversation of cohesion in any way. It was doing the exact opposite. So maybe the fact that we can't have those rallies is actually an excellent idea. What I would urge Kenyans is do read the report, see what is in it. Because if I remember, there was a section of politicians who were vehemently opposed to BBI before it came out. Yeah. Once the report came out, the ones were like, ah, is this it? They turned into petition. Maybe after they read BBI 2, they'll be like, oh, actually there's some excellent recommendations and okay. they will be happy to also petition. Okay. So as Kenyans, I would urge you, whether or not you are supportive of the process, just read, see what's inside.
Yeah.
If there's anything that has merit, please embrace that. If there's anything that's a load of rubbish, let us come out and critique it strongly. There's an election around the corner. If we really don't like what these guys have done, we can punish them for it in mm-hmm. 2 years' time. Okay. So for Kenyans, I would that would engage because we have spent a lot of time and energy and money on this process. We can't just call it a wash. Mm-hmm. Something has to come out of it for Kenyans. It must.
Okay, well, there we go. And yes, this is developing stories that we've touched on and we keep following up on the same just to see where, of course, it lands us. I mean, our biggest interest, and it's an interest that we hold by ourselves, is our own interest, because then, as they say, Mr. Mwishimiwa will never, never at all have your interest at heart. Jim Divo, thank you so much for the great insights. Yeah.
You're welcome. It's really fair that Mwishimiwa never has our interest at heart.
Do they?
I don't know. Maybe I might want to run for politics, but if that's the case, I don't want to run.
By the mere fact that you've said you do not know, is an outright answer to that question. Yeah?
But I agree, they could do more to communicate how much they actually care about the electorate mm-hmm. rather than treating the electorate like their serf, mm-hmm. basically their servants.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's where our leaders fail.
Yeah, thank you so much. And also thank you so much for your feedback back at home, the messages that are coming on. Of course, if we get time on the next laps, we'll be going through them. Thank you so much for the phone call, Peter. And you can keep calling because the conversation continues on our social media platforms. And we also cross over to a different segment altogether on Motors Lifestyle after this short break. Thank you so much for keeping it TV 47. Morning Cafe will be right back with more.